So thank you everyone for coming today. It's a pretty big crowd. You know, I know Sarah Davis had a lot to do with that, bringing in some people. So I was actually kind of expecting most of the crowd to be part of the accelerator. So I was just kind of curious, how many people are part of the accelerator right now? Okay, three or four of you guys. And then I think the other people that are here are just interested in learning about digital marketing strategies. Are most of the people here small business owners? Is that what's going on pretty much? Okay. Just trying to get a lay of it, maybe a little bit. Some people here just for the free food, you know, like, hey. That would have been me, all right? well, you know, I guess, like I said, most of these slides are geared with the accelerator people in mind. Just trying to really think through, like, where you guys are at and your budgets and your constraints and your limitations. So hopefully it will apply to everybody. But if not, obviously feel free to jump in and be like, well, how would this work for what I'm trying to do? And I'll try to answer that the best that I can. All right, so the title, of course, is Digital Marketing Strategies. You guys know why you're here. This is a huge picture of me, probably too big. It's a big screen here. But my contact information is here. I'm gonna get the slides to Brian, so if you guys want this deck of slides, just contact him and he'll distribute them out to you guys. And if you ever need to get a hold of me, this is my contact information. So that's actually my cell phone number too. So call me, email me, whatever is easiest for you. And of course, I'm at Marshall as well, so for the people that are local, stop by and visit me at Corbley Hall. So, you know, I think one of the things that, you know, what I want to do first is really just start from the basics of it all and try to, before we get into what digital marketing strategies are all about, just like what is marketing, right? Like, why is it important for what you all are doing? The way I always think about what marketing is, and really just business in general, is you got like three links on the chain, right? You've got the people that make stuff, then you've got people that use the stuff, right? So you've got consumers on one end, you've got the makers on the other end, and the makers could be engineers, right? They can make computers, they can make art, they can make cupcakes, they can make education, like, you know, we do at Marshall. There's all sorts of things that makers can make. And then there's the people that use it, and the people that bring them together are marketers, right? The people that take the stuff, bring it to the market, are marketers. And it's pretty intuitive, but a lot of people don't necessarily just get that intuition and why it's important. And because really what you have is, if you don't have that middle piece, if you don't figure out how to bring your product to the market, then what you really have is not necessarily a business or a product. You've just got a hobby, right? Like, there's a lot of great people that make great cupcakes. There's a lot of people that make great art, that make great 3D printed stuff. But unless you can bring it to the market and figure out how to bring it to the market, you've got a hobby, right? And it's an expensive hobby, but it's still a hobby because it's not sustaining itself. It's not sustaining your lives. So getting the marketing right is absolutely critical, because that middle piece in the chain is the difference between having a business and not having a business. So that whole idea of us taking what it is that you're valuable for, your product, and bringing it to the market, really when you think about it, all marketing is just increasing demand for your product, right? Like, that's ultimately the pure definition of marketing. There's this huge, long definition of marketing, and I never, ever use it. I never teach the students, and I do it for a specific reason, because instantly people, like, don't get it, because it's like three sentences long. And I tell them that the definition of marketing is, for my marketing students, is it's the piece of the business that creates demand for the product, right? Like, we're the connectors. We increase demand in the consumers so that they want to get our product from us, right? So it's not a hobby anymore. And with regard to digital marketing strategies, all we're doing is we're creating demand for our product in the marketplace using digital technologies. So how can we leverage digital technologies so we can increase demand for our products, right? So consumers want them. That's all we're trying to do. And when you hear the term strategies, all that really means is just what's the plan for it, right? So the digital marketing strategies defined would be simply increasing demand using digital technologies, the plan for that, right? That's all it is. And I think, generally speaking, when we think of digital marketing strategies, we just automatically are like, oh, well, I'll set up a Facebook account, I'll set up a Twitter, I'll set up an Instagram, I'll set up a web page, and boom, you know, we'll throw a bunch of pictures up there, and that's digital marketing, right? Well, that is digital marketing, but it's not digital marketing done well, right? Given that we have this little Venn diagram here of three things, I've set up today's talk with you guys with three chapters, I guess, or whatever, three parts. So the first part that we really have to know is, who do we communicate to? Who exactly do we communicate to, right? So these are our customers. Number two, what exactly are we communicating? What is it that we want to say? And believe it or not, this is more about us and the value that we bring, this what. And then step three, how do we communicate? So once we know them, once we know us and our value, then how do we communicate it? And I think going into this talk, most people would have been expecting this would be the only thing we talked about. But like I said before, it's all about this. This part is actually pretty easy. All right, so the first part, who do we communicate to? So I think the one thing that we're starting to see with marketing is it's become very analytic and it's become very objective. Everything's, you know, we study people's behavior, we put cookies on people's machines and learn all about where they clicked or search history. You probably see marketing ads following you all the time. They know you better than you know yourself. You know, it's become very objective in terms of tracking and data, digital marketing has. But in a way, and all that stuff is very important. I'm not saying don't use that data. Definitely use that data. It's important to know that data. But I'm talking about understanding who your customers are at a deeper level. And especially for the entrepreneurs here, you know, who may or not necessarily, analytics may not necessarily be, like high-level analytics may not be what y'all need. Sometimes what entrepreneurs need, startups need, is just talking to customers. Like literally, you know, talking to them, not like sending them a survey and watching their behavior and all that stuff, but just old school. You know, get in a room with some consumers, potential customers, and ask them stuff, right? Find out things like, what are your lifestyles like? You know, like how do you live your life? What are what motivates you? What are your thoughts and feelings? And you're probably like, oh my God, this is like touchy-feely. But really, if you think about what we're trying to do, the way that we create value in people's lives is by solving one of their problems, right? Like ultimately, everything that makes you valuable comes down to, can you solve a customer's problem? Can you meet a need that they have, right? So understanding how they live their life, understanding you know, how they think, all the psychology behind them, their needs, their problems, that's where the good stuff is, right? That's really how you really distill all of the stuff down to what you need to be, who you need to be, and what you need to offer. You know, ask them, hey, I've got an idea. What do you think about this potential solution? And you don't need this huge sample size. I think people get scared. They're like, oh, do I need to interview like 1,000 people? Because in statistics, you might need that. Like the stuff that I do, the research that I do, I need hundreds of people for my sample size. You don't need that. The small businesses don't need that. My mom and dad didn't need that. If their sweet and sour chicken wasn't working, they would know within the first few customers that it wasn't working, right? So I think what you have to do is you really have to talk to customers, right? You have to get a genuine, deep understanding, and you have to care about them a little bit, right? It all isn't all just about making money. We want to make money, but at the same time, the way we make money is this way, right? We solve problems. That's when we make money. People always think the goal of business is to profit. The goal of business is to solve problems. The reward for solving those problems is profit, and that's what keeps the system sustainable. But what the heart of every business should be. And I think as entrepreneurs, you probably got into it for that reason. I think you probably saw a problem. You're like, hey, I can fix that, right? Like, I think I can fix that. I think that's why I love entrepreneurs, because you guys are problem solvers. But get it. Talk to the customers. Find out what those problems are. Get a real, real understanding of them, and do it all the time. Do it all the time. Iterate, iterate, iterate. You will see these two slides, talk to customers and iterate, probably 4 or 5 times, over and over and over again. Because if there's one thing that I want to leave you with, is that you have to get in there, and you have to do it over and over and over again, right? So every time you talk to them, you evaluate, what did I learn? How can I adapt? How can I make my business better? How can I offer more value? How can I solve more problems? Iterate and adapt. Talk, iterate, adapt. Talk, iterate, adapt. It's the most important thing. All right, so if you do that, at some point you will get a very good understanding of who your customers are, who you need to communicate to. And again, you have to know your customers inside and out for it to work. Then you get into step two, what is it that we want to communicate? What are we trying to say to people through our digital technologies? There's really two things. And I mean, there's a lot of things but that you could talk about, but in my mind, the best businesses, big or small, communicate two things, and they do it really, really persuasively and effectively. The first thing is they communicate their brand, right? And the brand, what a brand is, it's who you are, right? It's your reputation, it's your image, it's your background, it's what people think of you. When I say brand, I'm not just talking about the product name, and I'm not just talking about a logo. Like I'm talking about who you are as a business, right? That's the first thing you want to communicate is who you are. And the second thing you want to communicate is your value. What do you do? What do you bring into the table to solve these problems? So at the end of the day, it's about who you are and about what you do. And you have to, that you see below, and these are examples of what I thought were good missions. I don't know if I'll show you any of these because we might not have the time, but just they're for your future reference whenever you go back. If you want the slides, check them out. But your mission, that's part of your brand, your purpose, right? Your values are part of who you are. Like, what do you stand for? What things are you saying? This is non-negotiable. This is what we're about, and it's non-negotiable. This is who we are, right? What are your values? And actually, we'll show you Intuit's values because that's a little obscure, I know. So I thought Intuit had some really neat values here. So some examples of their values. Can you guys see that, or should I blow that up a little bit? Where's the plus sign? So they have, however many there are there. So be bold, right? Be passionate, be decisive, learn fast, win together, together, and deliver awesome, right? Classic Silicon Valley cool guy, right? And like all that. So integrity without compromise. So all of these things are their values, right? These are non-negotiable things. Everybody in their business, anybody they hire has to have these values, right? That's what we're talking about there. All right, and culture, another part of brand. How do we live? How do we treat our employees? What's our atmosphere going to be like? How do we treat our customers? How do we treat ourselves? All these types of things are culture. An example of culture in a mission statement is, I thought Baylor had an interesting one. This is Baylor's College of Business, which I can't remember. Was it Haymaker, I guess? Handmaker? I don't know. Handcammer School of Business. Their mission, we cultivate principled leaders and serve the global marketplace through transformational learning, impactful scholarship, and here's the important part, in a culture of innovation guided by Christian values, right? So I thought this was a good example of like how they're really, really focusing in on their values and their culture, right? It's part of their mission. And if you think about Baylor, that's what you think of, right? Like you think of how they're this Christian school, but they're also pretty innovative as well. You can see it in everything that they do. So I thought that was a good example of who they are. Your history and heritage, where are you from? Where did, you know, like who started your business? Very, very important to get this across. Right now I'm working with a special needs nonprofit organization called Developmental Therapy Center, and we're trying to raise $1 million for this company, which is a lot of money for a company that nobody's ever heard of. They brought me in because they're like, hey, we need branding, we need awareness. And I was like, okay, let me check out what you guys have done. And like, they didn't have any of this, right? They didn't have any awareness. You can't even get awareness if you don't know any, like what are people gonna be aware of, right, is the question. So they had this amazing history. This company, for those of you all from Huntington like me, this company has been around since 1951. I had never heard of them. And if you're from here, and you're probably like, I've never heard of them either. That's not good, right? They have this amazing history and heritage. They've been here for so long, and no one has ever decided to communicate that to people. So one of the things I'm redoing right now is their website. And that was the first thing I did is, let's tell the story of this amazing history of how we've helped so many kids. And we've been doing it for a long, long time, right? Like, maybe then people might, you know, want to donate. But until then, who are you, right? So history, heritage, very important. The link I have here is Chick-fil-A, right? They have a really cool history. Personality. So this one's always one that trips people up. But basically, if your business was a person, what would they act like? How would you describe their characteristics? Like people describe me as like maybe energetic, So if you were a business, what words would they describe you as? And I think this, the easier way, I'm starting to think there's a better way to describe that. Think of like maybe a celebrity, right? Like if your business was a cartoon character or actor or somebody famous that you know of that has a well-defined personality, right? Rather than just obscure excitement or humorous or whatever, maybe just think of a celebrity or an animal or something that's easier to, that has well-defined characteristics and personalities, and then ask, what dog would you be? What celebrity would you be? And I don't know, maybe that will work better. We'll try this out here in a second. But yeah, just how would you describe yourself if you were a person? And finally, your identity. And this is the thing that I think most people associate with marketing. Like, they talk about identity. What do you look like, right? Like, what colors, Marshall, we're green and white, right? Nike is black check mark. What do we sound like? What do we look like and what do we sound like? That's our identity. But you really have to have all six of these things really, really well defined in order to for people to know who you are. This is a little bit more about identity and how you should look and how you should sound. You can actually build guidelines so you can have consistency across your entire business of how you look and sound. So there are branding, usually there, you know, when people develop branding literature for, or branding guidelines for businesses, they'll actually give them like the specific colors that their color is made out of. Like there's like this RGB number that gives you the specific green that Marshall is. So you can actually build guidelines so everyone uses those exact same colors. All the emails are the same, all the headers and all your departments are the same.
Logoing,
billboards, literature. And again, what you're seeing is all this stuff is just all about consistency. I can't find it, it's too long. But if you go back and you check, you'll actually see everything is broken down. Fonts, colors, how you should sound, how you should look, examples of all the collateral. So it's comprehensive, especially for a large organization like Marshall and SIU to have these types of guidelines. Now maybe for you with if you have, you know, a staff of 20 to 30 or whatever, then maybe you don't need a 60-page brand guideline book, but I think some general basic guidelines are good, right? Good to have. So the question I have for you guys right now as you start thinking about your businesses is your business well-defined? How well-defined is your business? Does your business have a clear identity? Does your brand have a clear identity? I'll give you a sheet here in a second, which we'll test that a little bit. Ryan, I'm a professor, I gotta test you guys. So the way you find out if you're well-defined and whether you have a clear identity isn't just from you saying, hey, you know, I can answer some questions. It's also, what do your customers think, right? Do they think you have a clear identity? Do they think you're well-defined? So talk to customers, get an understanding for what they think, iterate, right? If you don't have a well-defined identity, you don't have a well-defined brand, adapt. Change it. Get one that does, right? Listen to them. So that's who you are. Now, what do you do? What value are you bringing to the table? Again, this is so big, right? Like, this is ultimately the meat of it all. I mean, our brand is important, but the value we bring, even more important, right? So what creates value? Ultimately, value is just two things. It's just two things and two things only. It's the benefits that your product brings to the table and the cost. And they're constantly working against each other, right? Like in people's heads. If people think you're valuable, or if people are trying to assess if you're valuable, if they're trying to determine if your product has value and they're going to pay money for it, then the two things that are going on in their head is what are the benefits versus what are the costs, right? And in their minds, hopefully for you, it's, hey, it's got a lot of benefits and it's worth its price, right? So what value ultimately is it worth its price? Are the benefits of this product worth its price, right? And that's what we're always trying to market, that it is. These are our benefits. And yes, and maybe you guys have more expensive products. I've always thought that that's a good thing to have expensive products. I don't think very many people buy the lowest priced thing every single time. Right, because we'd all be wearing like plain white t-shirts in here with no logos on it. People buy on a lot of other factors besides the lowest price, but you got to prove your benefits. But you got to prove your benefits. Why are you valuable, right? Why are you worth the price? It's because of the benefits. So you really have to understand what ways are you solving these problems and solving these needs. And the other side of benefits, and this is kind of a new one, you know, being into it, I kind of learned a decent amount from them. The one thing that they really focus on over there isn't just like the functionality of a product and like the utility, but one of the big things, if you notice, like all the companies out in Silicon Valley, they're about like great design, right? Like you think about Apple's iPhone and how elegant the design is. People always talk about the elegance of the design, and like it has more to do with, if you really want to be great, it has more to do with just functionality alone. It's also like what emotions do you stir up with your product. You know, even in the B2B businesses, you're probably like, wow, that's weird, but it's true. Like, you know, Intuit is tax software. Well, how more B2B, you know, like they're super, I mean, that's not an iPhone, right? It's not cool. But what they're trying to do is they always go for delight. They always want to generate the delight emotion, right? So it's, yes, it's functional, it works, it gets your taxes done, but people, is it easy to use? Is it elegant in design? You know, can you create that level of benefit? And to me, that is a higher level than just does it work, right? And I'm not saying, by the way, if it works and it pays the bills and it's all you want to do, that's great. But I just wonder if there's going to be a company down the road that beats you, right? Because if you can have all your bases covered and really try to figure out how you can best benefit your target market and your customers because you understand them so well that you can create these types of emotions in them in addition to the utility. It's going to be really, really tough to beat. It's emotional. It's an emotional attachment, right? Like, oh wow, you know, you're never going to believe something you're emotionally attached to. So, anyways, those are the benefits. The costs. So people, and I'm not just talking about necessarily prices and sticker price. So there are financial costs to the customer that you have to understand, that you have to set. But you also have to think of the non-financial costs as well, right? Like time. Convenience, we see that a lot. Like, are you convenient enough for them? Maybe the price is good enough, but maybe they won't buy from you because of you're in a location that's bad, right? Or your salespeople aren't the best or whatever. Maybe it's a reputation thing. Maybe your brand is so bad that they won't buy from you because they don't like the logo, right? And they think it's lame. You know, I know it's weird to say that, and you're like, oh, we're adults, but like if you have a, I don't know what your businesses are, but if you have a business that target markets kids and high schoolers, reputation matters, right? Reputation matters a lot. Your branding matters a lot, right? So what are the non-financial costs that could potentially outweigh your benefits and lose value to your customer in your customer's eyes? And then what negative emotions do they cause, right? So it's not just about causing delight, but can you cause bad ones as well in our market's head, that's in our consumer's head. What we can control is how well we've defined our value and how well we propose our value, right, and our value proposition. Here's Walmart's, and I don't know their actual value proposition. This is just ostensibly what I think it would probably be. If I had to take all of their benefits and put it into a sentence, and also the costs, right, the costs and the benefits, and put it into a system, into a sentence, this is what I think their value proposition would say. I think this is what they're trying to communicate to their consumers. Walmart, every day, and everything, by the way, everything in yellow is value related. Everyday low prices, right, so that's the cost. Everyday low prices for a broad range of goods, that's benefit number one. They have a broad range of goods that are always in stock. Maybe that's not necessarily true, but we'll go with it. That's a proposition. Like in my mind, you know, my perception is that's not always the case, but that's what they're proposing. In convenient locations, right? So right here this doesn't show up very well. We see the cost element, and we see 1, 2, 3 different benefits, a bundle of benefits, right? And when you read that sentence, you really get a good idea. Like, that's what Walmart's all about. That's the value they bring, right? And there's no branding there, really. I mean, there's a little bit of branding, but for the most part, that's just a straight-up sentence of what they're bringing to the table. Very clear, very straightforward. A question for you guys. Are you valuable, right? Are your benefits worth the price when you're thinking about your business? How do you find out? Talk to customers. Ask them, what is your perception on our value proposition? Do you think do you think we bring enough to the table? Are you willing to pay for that? Is our price too high? Or like not just price, but cost. Is our cost too high? Adapt, right? After you find that out. Can you distill everything you do down to these three statements? And then can you distill it into something that conveys it all, right? That's your position. That's a good positioning statement. So now we know all these three things, and our positioning statement is essentially where everything meets, right? Your customers, why you're valuable, and you, your positioning statement captures all of those things. That's what you're trying to communicate. That's the answer to this, right? That's the answer to this. Now, finally, to the part you're all here for, and I'm gonna spend 10 minutes on it, right? Is how do we communicate all this stuff? How do you communicate who we are and what we do? And the way that I'll sort of break it down is into like seven parts, and this could be a document, right? This could you could visualize this probably as an outline or an outline or a skeleton. So the first thing you want to do is your mission statement. Why are we in business, and what business are we in, right? That's the first thing that should be defined in your plan or in your strategy. Second thing is who are we? What's our brand? Third thing, what do we do? Our value proposition. Fourth thing, who are our customers? Who's our target market? Fifth thing, positioning. How are we different? How are we different than everybody? Our positioning statement. So those are the things we all just talked about, right? You'll just outline those out in your plan, in your strategy. Now we get to step six, which is what digital tools will you actually use to communicate your position to the customers, right? That's the marketing tactics part. And then step seven, optimize. How can we get better next time, right? And then it just loops over and over and over again, right? So start seven goes back to one, but really we'll spend most of our time now on six and seven. So marketing tactics. The marketing tactics that I like to use are inbound marketing tactics. And there's traditional marketing tactics that you guys are probably used to, television ads that interrupt your TV shows, pop-up ads, email spam, magazine ads, newspaper, all that kind of stuff is traditional marketing. It's interruptive marketing. People don't actually want that stuff, right? Like you don't like it when a commercial comes up. It's interrupting what you're trying to do. Inbound marketing is the opposite of that. Instead of marketing that interrupts people's lives, you create marketing content that's so good and is so important in their lives that they actually come to you to get it, right? Hence the term inbound, right? The customers are coming to you to come get your marketing content. So the question is how do you do that? How do you get people to actually want your marketing, right? It almost seems like counterintuitive. Well, the first thing is, and there's only really two steps to it. The first thing is you have to create valuable content. Ostensibly, you know what your customers need, right? Because you've gotten to know them really well through talking to them. So can you create content that's valuable to their lives, but also on brand? Is it also on brand, right? Is it something that you would say and you would know? So there's two different types of, two general pools of valuable content. There's informative content and entertaining content, right? So informative content is, could you create a tutorial, right, of your business? Because your customers would probably care about that, right? The people that would care about a tutorial in your business would probably also be the same ones that's gonna buy your products. So again, cupcakes, I always do cupcakes for some reason. Like if I had a tutorial on how to make a cupcake, you know, the people that would be interested in that are probably the same people that are gonna buy my cupcakes. Archives, statistics, a careers page, advocacy content, all this is very, very good informative content that people, that your customers probably want, right? Entertaining content, of course, this is the stuff that goes viral all the time, is the entertaining stuff, right? Is the humorous stuff, the artistic, the inspirational stuff, memes, right? Like those are the types of things that also are valuable in a different way than informative. But you know, you might have a brand personality that's more suited to entertainment content rather than informative content. If you're a TED Talk, then you probably want to be more in the informative. If you're, you know, Comedy Central, maybe you want to go this route, right, with your content. But creating valuable content is the very, very first step. That's the main heart of inbound marketing. The second thing is you have to be easy to find. Once you create all that content and you know who you are, you've got your positioning statement, you've got all this stuff, you have to be easy to find, right? So one thing you can do is this thing, it's this this digital marketing term called SEO, which some of you may have heard of, maybe some of you haven't. SEO stands for search engine optimization. And all that means is how high up the list can you be on Google, right? Like if somebody types in Google cupcakes, is your business the first one? That's what search engine optimization is, right? It's trying to get you to the top of Google. And I would say Bing, but no one uses Bing, right? Who cares about Bing? So they should just call it Google optimization, right? Like that's the only search engine anyone uses. So that's what you want. And there's, by the way, that's a whole field into itself. Right there, the new thing, augmented reality, virtual reality, AR and VR. And I wish there's actually a startup company with you guys in your cohort who actually, that's what he does. He does VR, and I wish you were here today. But what he's got is this. Have you ever seen like the cardboard boxes where you insert your cell phone and you put them on like goggles? His technology, he's got drones, and what he does is he takes pictures of huge campuses like Marshall, for instance, and he kind of does like a Google Maps or Google Worlds kind of thing with them, where you put on these goggles and you can see the whole campus, and then you can drill down into each building and into the rooms. So it's really good for like international students who are thinking about coming to Marshall. Oh, you don't have to be in Huntington, right, to see if you like Huntington. You can put on his headset and check it out virtually. And it's 360, like you can go like this and you can see all around you. It's a really immersive experience. It's really, really cool. And even the goggles, he's branded the goggles, like the cardboard box that you put your cell phone into. Like it had this Marshall theme to it. Really neat thing. But augmented reality, getting bigger. Even though there's all this content that you can create, another big source of content creation that people often forget about is content that other people create. Things like if you build up enough good, hopefully good vibes about your brand, other people will start talking about your brand, right? I know that, like, do you remember those Mayhem Allstate ads where the guy walks around and then like the whole house collapses? There's like an entire series of parodies out there of people doing those Allstate ads on their own. Like they just create like their own, like it's a huge meme of them. Or not meme, but whatever, it's a huge influx of them. So there's customer created content that's out there. And remember, hopefully it's good. You don't control that stuff, right? Hopefully it's good. And then you can also pay people to create content for you. Like you may feel like you don't have enough time to do all this stuff. Like how do I create all this content? Like I gotta be in all this, I gotta do all this stuff. Yet, if you're a small business that doesn't have the resources and you wanna do it, then yeah, you might have to pick and choose what you do, but yeah, I mean, you'll probably have to do it yourself. But if you feel like you have enough of a budget to do this, then you can hire people to do it as well. And it's actually cheaper than you think. Like, there's a website here called $99 Social, which I've linked for you guys, and they'll create content for you for $99 a month. And I don't know how much content they'll create for you, but they'll figure out what your field is, and they'll create content for you for a month for $99. And then there's also a company called Fiverr. And Fiverr is it's everything. Like they have graphic designers up there, they have video production, they have a lot of different types of freelancers that will create digital marketing for you for $5. And by the way, $5 will get you like a little sample if you want like higher end stuff. It gets more expensive. I use them quite a bit. So those people can help you create content if you can't create it yourself, right? If you don't have time to, because you could be a one person operation, right? So that's the first part, valuable content. Second thing, be easy to find, right? Make sure your website is search engine optimized, right, for Google. Social media wise, we wanna make sure that, you know, I guess this, what I really should say is all this stuff kind of has its own social media, right? So when you create this content, then you wanna distribute it and be easy to find on those respective social media. So like, you know, obviously if you're doing microblogging, Twitter. If you're going to be making video content, probably YouTube, right? So pictures, Instagram, memes, you know, things like that. So all of these things kind of have a home naturally, you know. So it's really just trying to figure out what those homes are, and if your consumers are actually using those social medias as well, right? Like if your target market isn't on Twitter, then you know. Probably shouldn't use it. Microblogging may not be for you too at that point, right? Because you don't have an outlet. So another thing that can make you easy to find is, again, advertising, but make sure it's targeted advertising. So if you do targeted advertising, Google AdWords is a good one to use. I don't know how much you guys know about advertising like Google AdWords, but basically you only pay for every time somebody actually clicks your ad. So it's kind of a low cost way of doing advertising because they're paying per clicks as opposed to, you know, some, and you can define how much you're going to pay. You have like this budget. You can say, hey, I want to throw $15 or $50 into Google advertising, and it will just keep going until that budget runs out. Retargeted display ads. When I was talking about earlier about how advertising will follow you around when you visit ESPN.com or wherever, that's called retargeted display advertising. That's the name of it. I'm kind of going through quick because I know I'm running out of time here. Another way to be easy to be found is by, and this is a big one by the way, is figuring out who in your target market is influential. Who's important, like who's somebody that shares a lot of stuff and has a lot of friends, ultimately on social media. You have to find those people, it's critical. And there's companies that'll help you identify that, Clout, BuzzSumo, FollowerWonk, all of these sites will help you find key influencers, which is very, very important. I can't actually, in terms of being found, you know, make sure that these people know who you are. Affiliate bloggers are also good. So let's say that you're in the plane industry and there's a famous blogger that, not famous, but a well-known blogger that blogs about planes. You might be able to contact that person and see if you can do some deals where he or she will plug your brand in there, right? Your product in there, and talk about it and blog about it. Maybe you give them some free stuff so they can blog about it. So very important stuff. Email blasting is still a good idea, but once again, make sure it's targeted advertising, targeted emailing. And then this is really important as well, content calendar. So when you have all this calendar, when you have all this content, make sure you develop a calendar so you have it all planned out, right? Like, You don't want to just hit people with a ton of information at once. Maybe you space it out where it's one time a week. I feel like it's a good tool for most small businesses. So start developing out a strategy. Third thing, most importantly, keep learning. All this stuff, this software changes so quickly. This slide deck will probably be outdated in a year with totally new, and I'll have to put totally new links in there. There are free online classes that teach you how to do all of this stuff. Google Analytics, there's certifications free. HubSpot, which is an inbound marketing service. HubSpot is very, very good. Free certification there. Hootsuite, the social media aggregator I was telling you about, free. Google AdWords, Code Academy, on how to develop a website. All those things are free and they'll teach you how to do them. You have to keep adapting. If you don't adapt, it's over, right? Gotta make sure you stay up to speed. I talked a lot there in the last 15 minutes, right? That's all I got, but I do want to open the floor up for questions if you guys have any. And if you guys have to go, I know it's probably a little bit past time. I'm sorry to keep you over, but if you guys have any questions, I want to know what they are. I'll try to answer them. And if you have to go, that's cool too. So do I have any questions here? No? Okay. And I'll stick around a little bit afterwards.